welcome. We're so glad that you're here joining us. We invite you to stand as we sing. Psalm 19:1 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hand." Will you join us as we celebrate his holiness and worship the Lord Jesus Christ?
It's falling from the clouds, a strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and the rain. It's ringing in the skies like cannons in the night. The music of the universe plays. We're singing, "You are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you
teach you a song now, and it is called the Throne Room Song. And the image in this song is from that scene in Revelation where the elders and the saints, they bow before the Lord God and they worship him in all his holiness and his righteousness and his truth. But because of the work of the Lord Jesus Christ and his victory over sin, experientially, we as believers in Jesus Christ can enter his presence even right here and right now. The veil has been torn. The veil has been lifted from our darkened hearts that we can enter and be in God's presence as a body of believers. So as we sing this together, recognize that this is a precursor of eternity when we are in Jesus' presence, singing and praising him, glorifying him in his majesty and splendor for all of eternity. I invite you to sing with us as you learn this song.
Before you, I bow. The pale is
To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb be glory and honor and power and dominion forever and ever. Would you please remain standing as our global outreach partners, Brad and Pam, come and they're going to read scripture to us this morning. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for that worship. That was awesome. Good morning. My name is Brad, and this is my wife, Pam, and we are global partners, and we have the privilege of serving the Lord in the Arabian Gulf. This morning, we're going to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus as Lord, and ourselves as your bondservants on account of Jesus. For God who said, light shall shine out of darkness, is the one who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. You may be seated.
Please join me in prayer. Jesus, we give you honor today, and we thank you for who you are. Without your shed blood and your resurrection, we wouldn't know you, so we thank you for that. And we thank you, Lord, for True Light Christian Church. And as you are with them, among them, and encouraging them as they reach out, Lord, as build unity among them and help them as they train their children and young adults, and maybe someday, one day, going forth and out to the world. Lord, we pray for those who are persecuted in Kazakhstan. We pray for that country, Lord, that you would take hold of that country. It's yours, you created it. You see them, you love each one there. And we pray for those who have left Islam to follow Jesus, and you would wrap your arms around them and help them endure persecution. Lord, we also pray for Tony Vasquez, who has recently lost his wife, Brenda, that you would wrap your arms around him and his children and their families, Lord. Help them in this time of grief. Comfort them, Lord. Wrap your arms, just hold them up during this season. And Lord, we thank you for this time, Pastor Keith, and the sermon. You would just bless this message. Bless us, help us to hear, to understand, and to have hearts to obey. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you so much, Brad and Pam. We are so grateful to have you as Global Outreach Ministry partners. Thank you for decades of ministry service, and especially to the Muslim world. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts. We praise God for you. Isn't it good to be in the presence of the Lord this morning? I was so excited to be with you and was just reminded again of what a privilege it is to be able to open God's Word together. And as I thought about Brad and Pam, I was reminded of the freedom that we have here at Crossroads Bible Church and ultimately in our country to hear God's Word, to study God's Word, to have unlimited access to God's Word, and to be able to meet whenever we want, however we want. That's a gift from God. And we're grateful that we have that freedom, and we're going to enjoy it as long as it lasts. This past Friday, I had my annual eye exam. Now, I don't look forward to eye exams. They're not as bad as dental exams, but eye exams are no fun either, because obviously, my vision is not getting better. It's getting worse. That just happens with age. Now, I expect that, obviously, and so do you as you go in for your annual eye exam. But what was a little unexpected was what the eye doctor told me. She said that my right eye is nearsighted and my left eye is farsighted. Now, you might think that that would be a good thing, but the problem is my two eyes are working separately, not in harmony. I'm like a lopsided pair of binoculars. Now, the reality is, being nearsighted and farsighted has advantages, but it also has disadvantages. And in our day and age, There's a tendency for all of us to be focused in on being nearsighted, at least spiritually speaking. In other words, we're focused on the here and now. We're focused in on what we hope will occur in our lives and ministries now. But many of us are discouraged in our lives and ministries, aren't we? We're banking so much on the enjoyment of the here and now, but it's not very enjoyable, particularly in our ministries. So if you're serving the Lord in your neighborhood or in your school by sharing Jesus Christ with others, you may find that a bit discouraging. Or if you're working for a nonprofit and you're helping people who are down and out get up and out, you may find that discouraging at times. I mean, it's discouraging just taking our faith into the marketplace, isn't it? It's hard to know how to live the Christian life in our community. And of course, many of us are serving in kids' ministry, in student ministry, and some of us are community group shepherds. And even though we love these ministries, there are times when they are discouraging. So the question is, what do we do in the midst of discouragement, and why are we discouraged? Well, if we're honest, most of us are focused in on fruit and results. And when we don't see them, we tend to get discouraged. But then there's also issues like the believers or the pre-Christians that we're ministering to. They end up hurting us or even betraying us, the very people that we're trying to serve. And then, of course, many of you know what it's like to have personal challenges. Physical and emotional challenges, family challenges, and even financial challenges. When you're serving the Lord in ministry, things can get very discouraging. So how can we be encouraged in our ministries? How can we be encouraged ultimately in our lives? The Apostle Paul is going to answer that question for us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. And what Paul is going to do is he's going to share with us three ministry necessities. Three ministry necessities that will help us to find encouragement, or at least contentment, in our lives and ministries. You'll see the first one in verses 1 and 2. And that is maintain ministry integrity. What Paul is going to say is, we need to be people who refuse to quit and ultimately are committed to speaking the truth in love. Look at how he begins in verse 1. In verse 1, he writes, therefore, since we have this ministry, as we received mercy, we do not lose heart. Now, Paul begins with the use of the word therefore, and that ties back into the previous context. But we don't know how far back it goes until we look at the next phrase. Since we have this ministry. Now, Paul has been talking about new covenant ministry, and he's been talking about the work of the Holy Spirit and how it's transformational. That really started in chapter 2, verse 14. And it is extended all the way through chapter 3, verse 18. And then Paul immediately picks up this theme again in chapter 4, verse 1. And you'll notice that he says, we have received mercy. How do we have a ministry? It's because God himself has given us a ministry. Now, it's easy for us to think that we are God's gift to ministry. But really, ministry is God's gift to us. And it comes about through his mercy. That we have received mercy, not just for salvation, but also for service. And the key concept is the mercy that God provides. There was a man who had his picture taken by a photographer. And the man was shown his picture, and he became very agitated, even irritated with the photographer. And he said to the man, This picture doesn't do me justice. And the photographer said, Mister, your face doesn't need justice, it needs mercy. Now, many of us can relate to that. But we're not talking about physical mercy per se, we're talking about spiritual mercy. Mercy is that which is given to us that we don't deserve, ultimately. Justice is getting what we deserve. We don't want justice, we want mercy. And so Paul says, when you're thinking about your ministry, when you're discouraged in the midst of ministry, focus in on God's mercy. That God himself called you to himself, and then he enabled you and empowered you to serve him in practical and tangible ways. Now, how do we celebrate, if you will, God's mercy? Well, some homework for you is to go into Luke's gospel and to read all 24 chapters, if you're willing. And what you'll find is Luke's gospel emphasizes words associated with mercy more than the other three gospels. And if you're looking for a quick homework assignment, you can go to one of my money chapters, Romans chapter 9, and you can see how Paul weaves a theme of mercy throughout Romans chapter 9. So basically, your two options are one chapter or an entire book. Or for those of you who are zealous, you can take both homework assignments. Paul is clear that we desperately need mercy. And our ministries are not dependent upon our merit. They are dependent upon what? Mercy. We often think it's our education, it's our experience, it's our spiritual gifts, it's the natural talents that we bring. And Paul is saying, no, it's just God's mercy upon you that he saved you and that he chooses to use you and me at all. So with this theme of mercy, Paul goes straight into this last phrase of verse 1. We do not lose heart. I love this phrase because it shows us that Paul himself actually had the thought of losing heart cross his mind. I mean, we think of the Apostle Paul as this ministry superstar, and he was, and he is. But Paul was also a man that grew discouraged at times. And all we have to do is remember what we've studied this far in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. Paul is suffering to such an extent he thinks he's going to die. He even says there's a sentence of death upon me. That's discouraging. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, has all kinds of reminders that Paul faced opposition from the Corinthian church. Remember, the Corinthian church? Paul led the Corinthians to faith in Christ. He then discipled them for 18 months. And then he let Apollos take over, and Apollos continued to disciple them. And they became the worst church in the New Testament. Talk about discouraging. Isn't it great to know that Paul himself had struggles with people and people's maturity in the Lord? I mean, if that's true of the Apostle Paul, how can that not be true of all of us? But then in chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, Paul faces uncertainty. He faces the tension of uncertainty in his ministry, and that causes him some angst. So did Paul struggle with the concept of losing heart? Oh, yeah. But Paul said, I'm going to keep on keeping on. I'm not giving in. I'm not giving up. I have a calling. And it was his calling that kept him in ministry. And it was a merciful calling. Remember the Damascus Road? Paul was called in an awe-inspiring way by Jesus Christ himself. And Paul never forgot that day. And it reminded him in his conversion and in his ministry how much he needed mercy. We have to ask the question again, How can we be encouraged in ministry? How can we remain encouraged in ministry? Mercy. At least that's what verse 1 says. So we think of what our lives were like prior to trusting in Christ. Do you remember what your life was like, BC, before Christ? Do you remember who you were? Do you remember what you were doing? God saved you from that. He saved me from that. Even if you were converted as a child, you were spared a whole lot of the sin that you would have committed if you could have. It's God's mercy. But then the mercy doesn't stop there. The moment you trusted in Christ, you were called to a life of ministry. That's in the workplace, that's in the home, that's in the church, that's in the community. It's everything that you and I do. It's ministry. Do you remember what your life was like before you had purpose and significance in serving the Lord? God ensures that a lot of our sense of identity and maturity is based upon serving Him and serving others. You may remember as a Christian or even as a pre-Christian, a life of purposelessness, a life of seemingly insignificance. And God gave you a call to ministry, and you began to serve Him and you began to serve others. Thank Him for that. Celebrate that. On your darkest days of discouragement, if we are profusely and continuously giving God praise for His mercy, we may have some difficult days, but we're not going to have truly bad days. At least not in the spiritual sense. Because even when our lives are crashing down around us, those of us who have trusted in Jesus Christ, we're still going to spend eternity with Him. And if He gives us life and breath, we still have another day to serve Him. That's mercy. That's not merit. It's all by God's mercy and grace. Now in verse 2, Paul is going to tell us what he doesn't do and what he does do with this mercy. And he's going to also tell us how he doesn't lose heart. Verse 2 reads, "But we have renounced the things hidden because of shame, not walking in craftiness or adulterating the word of God, but by manifestation, or better yet, proclamation of truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God." Paul uses a word translated renounced that's not used anywhere else in the New Testament. It's a strong word. It means to disown or reject. It means to turn away from. Paul says, "I made a decision that I would not be guilty of things that were hidden that ultimately created shame." Now, we immediately tend to think of alcoholism, drug abuse, pornography, all kinds of unethical behavior. But that's not what Paul is talking about here. He's talking about things that should be hidden, but are actually open in the revelation or in the proclamation of God's word. So he talks about at least two of those things in verse 2. You can see he talks about not walking in craftiness or in trickery. Paul is simply saying he came in such a way that he did not rely upon eloquence. He didn't rely upon persuasion. He didn't try to use a bait and switch. He simply came as an ethical man of integrity. But Paul goes on and he says in verse 2 that he did not adulterate, or some of your English versions will have tamper or deceive with the word of God. I like the term adulterate. Paul is saying he did not do anything that would mess with God's word. He just delivered it. He preached it, he taught it, he discipled with it, And he didn't bring his own interpretations. He didn't express a lot of his own views. He just proclaimed the word of God and let it stand. Now, it's important as we read this text, which will have quite a bit to do with preaching and proclamation, that we understand something very fundamental. It is God's expectation that all God's people would proclaim or preach. We tend to think that preaching is just what we do on an elevated platform. That wasn't the case in the New Testament. They preached in cities and villages, in synagogues. They preached in homes. And it had nothing to do with the size of the audience. I know people who have preached to me in one-on-one discussions. Sometimes they'll even stand up while I'm sitting down and they'll start hammering down. They'll preach at me and to me. And I always say to them, you know, every preacher loves a preacher. So you go ahead, you bring it. You bring it to me. We have to get over this idea that preaching is for professionals. In local churches that I've served, I have taught preaching to both women and men. Pastor Alex Cotto and our other pastors have done the same. We believe that preaching is for the church. So if we understand that, all of a sudden these verses have some application, and they're not just for pastors or for leaders. When you look at what Paul is talking about here, you can see how easy it is for us to feel that we need to proclaim, preach, or speak things that people want to hear, not what they need to hear. How does this happen? Well, it happens when we start omitting concepts like wrath, sin, and judgment. I mean, those aren't popular concepts. And we don't want to talk about those things with pre-Christians or Christians. It's far easier to talk about a God of love, a God of mercy, a God of grace. The only problem is the greatest preacher of all time, Jesus Christ, he spoke about hell more than he spoke about anything. Hell and money. The two topics that preachers never want to speak on. So if we're to model our lives and ministries after Jesus, we speak what Scripture speaks, and we let Scripture handle people's hearts and minds through the Holy Spirit. It's easy to not want to talk about issues of the day that deal with sexual immorality or integrity. We just want to sort of skip over those things because we could offend someone. But the question that we need to ask is, would we rather offend people or would we rather offend God? When we skip discipleship and we give the impression that, well, the Christian life is one of health, wealth, and prosperity, and discipleship is such a joyous life, and there's no thorns in the roses of the Christian life. We give people the impression that discipleship is a cakewalk. And then when things get tough, which is usually a day after they are converted, they fall away from the faith because we haven't helped them to understand the discipleship demands that follow believing in Christ. Paul wants us to unleash the word of God and have confidence that God himself can save people and he can grow people in Christ. We don't need to help God out. We don't need to add or subtract from his word. His word is sufficient and then some in and of itself. Now, Paul tells us not only what he doesn't do, he tells us what he does do in verse 2. He says, "But by the proclamation of truth, commending ourselves to every person's conscience in the sight of God." In other words, Paul preaches, he teaches, he proclaims, and we are to do the same. And we are to do so in a way that pleases God and ultimately frees us from the guilt of not articulating Christ and God's word to people that we deeply care about. Yes, we trust in God's sovereignty. And God doesn't need us to share the gospel with anyone. He doesn't need us to share his word with anyone. He can get the job done without us. But he's called us and commanded us to share the good news of Jesus and to serve him and to serve others. So we do that as a means of honoring the Lord. So what we've seen is we need to maintain ministry integrity. That is a ministry necessity. If you want to get really discouraged, forget all about God's mercy and live a life that lacks integrity. Then you'll get really discouraged, and so will I. Ministry necessity number two is an odd one. Expect spiritual warfare. In verses 3 and 4, Paul is going to say, a part of ministry is spiritual warfare. Satan is coming after the souls of anyone and everyone. Now, he can't take the souls of anyone, but he strives every day of his existence to render believers in particular ineffective. And he does something else to unbelievers that we will see in verses 3 and 4. Paul writes, and even if our gospel is veiled, there's our term again from chapter 3, it is veiled to those who are perishing, in whose case the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelieving so that they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Why would these two verses be in a context that's trying to help us to maintain encouragement? Because many of us forget that we're in a spiritual battle. And if we just thought about this on a daily basis, we would realize, oh, yeah, I should expect opposition. I should expect resistance. I should expect that fruit will be slow coming because the enemy of our souls, he's working at cross purposes with us. He's opposing us at every turn. If you expect that, and if you are prepared for that, you can avoid a whole lot of discouragement along the way. Now let's look at verses 3 and 4. The gospel is veiled, and it's veiled to those who are perishing. Verse 4 brings up the God of this world. Now this is a very tricky phrase, far more so than we might think. This particular term, God, is only used here of Satan in the entire New Testament. Because of that, there are scholars who would argue that this term is actually a reference to God, that God the Father blinds the minds of unbelievers. And we do see some of that in the Old and New Testament. So it's not like that's completely wacky. But others, more recently, are arguing that this is the Roman emperor who does this. He blinds the minds of unbelievers through his idolatry and through his religious rites and through persecution. The simplest way to understand this, though, is that the God of this world is Satan. Because we see this in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2, that Satan is the ruler of the air. The Apostle John talks about Satan as one who is in control of this world order. So it's not far off here to think of Satan as the one who does the blinding. But when you look at verse 4, you can see that ultimately what Satan is trying to accomplish is that people not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. He's trying to blind people so that they won't see the truth of the gospel. And he does that very, very well. But we need to understand something very, very important. And that is, the only reason Satan can do this is because God has permitted it. Some Christians just get so discouraged and so demoralized by what Satan is able to do in our culture and in our country. And you get the impression almost that Satan is winning the war and God is on his throne wringing his hands trying to figure out what he should do to match Satan's moves. I mean, that's ludicrous. Martin Luther said it so well. Even the devil is God's devil. How sovereign is God? He has authority over Satan. Satan even has to regularly ask his permission to do things. That's how sovereign God is. Just look at the Job account, and you'll get an idea of what Satan had to do just to have access to Job. So instead of being paralyzed with discouragement and fear, we need Christ's confidence. We need to know that God is in control, even over the diabolical activity that we see in this world order. But that does lead to a question. What should we do? What can we do? Well, first of all, and most of all, we should be committed to passionate prayer. Passionate prayer for unbelievers, or if you're really confident, pre-Christians, those who will trust in Christ by God's grace. You may want to use a 3x5 card and write down the names of unbelievers in your school, in your neighborhood, in your workplace. Write their names down. Type their names down into a memo app of some kind on your smartphone. And then just pray on a daily basis for unbelievers to trust in Jesus Christ as Savior. Pray that the Lord would take away Satan's blinding skill in the life of your family member, your friend, your coworker, your neighbor. Ask him to do that. Secondly, we should have great compassion for unbelievers. If they are unregenerate, which means they're dead in their trespasses and sins, if they do not have God's word as their holy book, if they are not indwelt by the Holy Spirit, why are we wagging our fingers at them when they are doing things that unbelievers are supposed to do? I mean, that's a part of their job description, to sin. And we're getting so upset that unbelievers are sinning, and then we let saints who are sinning have a free pass. My problem is never with unbelievers. My problem is with believers who sin. I know how hard it is for me to live a life of obedience to the Lord. How in the world can an unbeliever do that? He or she can't. And even if they can show forth an exterior life that looks impressive, apart from Christ, it doesn't please God. So we need to really get a hold of that. Let's worry about our own selves and our own sin and worry a whole lot less about unbelievers' sin. Unbelievers need the Savior. They don't need to stop sinning. The only way they can stop sinning is if the Savior comes and transforms them through His Holy Spirit. Amen. So we pray gospel-centric prayers. If we do these two things, and we do these two things well, we're going to begin to see the Lord bringing about a harvest in King County. If we pray, and if we have compassion, God will move in our midst, and He'll move in a powerful way. In fact, He already is. And I'm so thankful to so many of you who are sharing your faith in Jesus, who are taking bold stances to love unbelievers, to bring them into your home, to show them Christian hospitality, to not be focused on judging, but loving. So Paul is clear, we need to ultimately expect spiritual warfare. We need to expect it. No surprises here. Paul has told us in advance. Jesus has told us in advance. This is a part of the Christian life. It's not a playground, it's a battleground. So put on the full armor of God. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. Every morning, put your armor on. Every evening before you go to bed, put your armor on. Yes, yes. And God has uncanny ways of delivering us from the devil. So a third ministry necessity, you'll see that in verses 5 and 6, and that is preach Christ's gospel. Paul is going to say again, it is our responsibility to preach Christ. Remember? The original PC, not politically correct, preach Christ. We preach Christ's gospel. Gospel means good news. We have good news to share. We can be transformed by the grace of God. We can be recipients of God's mercy. Listen to Paul's words in verse 5. He writes, "For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus as Lord, and ourselves as your bondservants for Jesus' sake." Paul says, we don't preach ourselves. In other words, as important as our views and our opinions or even our thoughts are, that's not what's essential. What's essential is Christ, that Jesus Christ is Lord. That is what is the non-negotiable emphasis of everything that we share or should share. Now, this always leads to a very interesting question. Does that mean that I should never talk about myself? I mean, that's what the passage says, doesn't it? The problem with that thinking is the greatest gift that we've been given is God's mercy and grace in our own particular lives and ministry. And that's called a personal testimony. We get to share our lives and how our lives have been transformed by the grace of God through Jesus Christ. So yes, you can talk about yourselves. You can use illustrations about yourself. I don't like doing this. I do it because I love you and I want you to know me. And I'm going to be transparent. I'm going to be vulnerable. But I don't typically use any positive illustrations about myself. They're all negative or humorous. We need to see what Paul is saying here. He's saying, don't talk about your education. Don't talk about your experience. Don't talk about your talents. Don't talk about your good looks. Don't talk about your dynamic personality. Don't monopolize every conversation. Preach Christ as Lord. In other words, that he is God, not the Roman emperor in Paul's day, not any so-called God in our day. He is the King of Kings and he is the Lord of Lords. He is our master and we are to obey him and we are to live for him. And we share that with other people. And we make much of Christ because he's worthy. Everything else is temporal. Only Christ is ultimately eternal. I mean, I like talking about the same things that you do. I like talking about sports. I like talking about TV and movies. I like talking about vacations. I like talking about work. I like talking about my kids. We all like all these types of things, and that's wonderful. But how much are we proclaiming Christ? How are we trying to introduce Christ into a conversation? We have to do that. And we have to be prepared each and every day with anyone and everyone that we come in contact with. Verse 6 explains why Paul has such confidence in his preaching. It's explanatory with the use of the word for. For God, who said, "Light shall shine out of darkness," is the one who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Whoa! I have a prayer partner that I pray with every Thursday morning. His name's Dr. Brian Hurlbut. He's a pastor in Salt Lake City. And he has said to me again and again, this is the most beautiful and glorious gospel verse in the entire Bible. And I'll be honest, over the years, I haven't seen it as such. I have a number of other verses that come to mind. But ever since Brian began sharing that with me, I have studied it more and more and more, long before I ever started this series, and I realized it is glorious. It is wonderful. There are very few verses like this in the entire Bible. So if you're not familiar with this verse, or if you haven't thought about it as truly a showstopper of a verse, you might want to go back and work through this particular verse. What Paul does is he uses a number of allusions, a ton of them, but three are really apparent. The first one is Paul is clearly alluding to Genesis 1 verse 3. The first day of creation, the Lord said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Paul has this in mind when he is articulating 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. But it's interesting. The primary allusion he probably has in mind is actually Isaiah 9, verse 2. "The people who lived in darkness shall see a great light." And then if we fast forward to Isaiah 49, verse 6, that light is called the Messiah, the one that we know as Jesus Christ. And the light will come into the world, and that light will save the people from their sins. Salvation will spread throughout the entire earth. All of this was predicted by Isaiah the prophet. But then, if you look at the text carefully, you can see that Paul is also likely speaking of his conversion that I alluded to when we were in verse 1. In Acts 9, 22, and 26, all three passages where Paul shares his testimony and his conversion, he talks about a great light. Paul was converted from spiritual darkness. There was a veil over him. His eyes, his mind, his heart, it was blinded. God had to literally remove the scales and blind him temporarily. Paul likely has this in mind as well. And all of these allusions are so helpful. However, this is also our story. Whether we fully see it or not, we were in spiritual darkness. We were without hope in this world. We were spiritually dead. We weren't just sort of dead or kind of dead. We were deader than a doornail. We were 6 feet under, spiritually speaking. And God, in his mercy and grace, he saved us. He didn't just save us so that we could sit, soak, and sour. He saved us for service. He saved us so that we could make a difference. And I want to show you something that's amazing. If you go back to verse 5, you can see an important phrase, your bondservants, your bondservants. Why is service so important? Because Paul makes it clear everywhere else that he is a bondservant or a slave of Christ Jesus. But here and only here he says he's a bondservant, a servant, or a slave to the Corinthian church. You have been saved to serve. And God wants to use you and me to serve the body of Christ and to find encouragement ultimately in God's mercy and in the glorious gospel. So how do we boil everything down? Christ's glory provides mercy for ministry. So Christ's glory or Christ's light, they're synonyms here, they provide mercy for ministry. A mercy that we call upon each and every day. So in my annual eye doctor's appointment, I learned that my right and left eye weren't ideal because they didn't work well together. But in the spiritual realm, this can be a great advantage. If we realize that nearsightedness will actually cause us to focus in on the gospel of Jesus Christ and on serving one another, that can be a very good thing. And that's what we've been called to do. However, nearsightedness isn't enough. Because with that near view, with that present tense view, there will be all kinds of discouragement. Which is why we also need to be farsighted. We need to have this thought that the Lord's mercy will be fully given to us one day when we stand before Him. And He honors us for a life of service. That we chose to sacrificially serve the body of Christ, to lay down our lives for others within the body of Christ and see the church move forward. But not only the church, ministries in our community that are power tools for the church. How are we currently bringing the gospel to bear on our ministries within CBC? Our ministries in the community on the east side of Seattle? Our ministries at work? Our ministry in the home? How are we allowing Christ's light, His glorious light, how are we allowing Christ's light to provide mercy for our ministry? As I said earlier, there are difficult and disappointing days. There are discouraging, even demoralizing days. But there don't have to be ultimately bad days in the sense of our spiritual lives. We can walk with Christ. We can adore His mercy and grace, and we can give it out to other people. And in that, we find encouragement, and we choose as an act of our will not to lose heart. Crossroads, let's never quit. Let's persevere by God's grace in our faith and in our service. Let's pray together. Father, I pray this morning for so many of us who are weary, who are losing heart, who are discouraged. Lord, we acknowledge that there are no easy answers. There are mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual reasons that we are weary and discouraged. But Lord, we know that Your gospel can also lift so much of what we are experiencing. Father, thank You that Your mercy and grace, as it's extended to us, can give us the ability to continue to persevere by Your grace, not only in our salvation, but in our service. Help us to do that today, Lord. Help us to simply walk with You, be people of integrity, expect spiritual warfare, and proclaim Christ and His glorious gospel. Help us to find encouragement in these things, that our labor in the Lord is not in vain. And Father, we pray for those who have never trusted in Jesus Christ as Savior. This has been so clear, Lord, that You want to bring light to people. You want to illuminate people's hearts and minds. You want to transform them and take them out of the darkness into the glorious light. Father, I pray today that each and every person who has not trusted in Jesus Christ as Savior, whether they're here in this worship center or they're watching online, that they would cross over from death to life by acknowledging their sin, turning to the Savior, and staking their claim in the fact that their sin will take them to a Christless eternity, but that You have extended mercy and grace, and it's free. And all they must do is believe and entrust their eternal destiny to You. I pray that individuals will make that decision today and that You will draw them to Yourself. Thank You, Lord, for Your mercy and grace. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we have an opportunity to respond to the preached word, worshiping the Lord through singing. Thank you.
worship you, Jesus, is my sole desire. For this very heart you have shaped for your pleasure, purpose to lift your name high. Here in surrender, in pure adoration, I enter your courts with an offering of praise. I am your servant, come to bring you glory, as is fit for the work of your hand. Now unto the Lamb who sits on the throne, worship and praise Him, the Lord of Lords. Spirit now living and dwelling within me, keep my eyes fixed ever on Jesus' face. Let not the things of this world ever sway me. I'll run till I finish the race.
Give us boldness to preach the gospel with our lives. And oh Lord Jesus, we just thank you for this opportunity that we have to witness a Christian baptism. And we thank you for the boldness that this one is taking to proclaim you. We ask that you would bless this time, and we worship and we praise you. In your precious name, we say amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Church family, it was so wonderful to worship with you this morning, and I'm so excited for what's coming in the month of March. You heard from Pastor Zach last week that in the month of March, we are challenging every single one of our community groups, Sunday morning groups like Join Heirs, Sojourners, Covenant, Cornerstone, Generations, midweek groups that are meeting in homes, our intercultural community groups, our young adult groups. We're inviting every single one of our community groups to serve the King. We are challenging our community groups to serve King County, to bring the love of Jesus, the love of King Jesus, to our neighbors around King County. Now, we're not restricting this, strictly speaking, to King County, all right? Some of you came up and reminded Zach and I that we have people from Snohomish County here, and we probably have people from other counties, all right? So please, by all means, love those people as well, all right? They are just as in need of Jesus' love as King County. Now, what this is an invitation to find some way to serve our neighbors outside the walls of this church throughout the month of March. So I would encourage you to start with your community group leader asking the question, do any of us in our community group have a neighbor who's in need? And then begin there. If there's an opportunity to serve a neighbor by helping clean up their yard or any kind of help they may need, start there. Tell them that you're coming in the name of Jesus. Mention Crossroads if you think that they may need a church family. And then when you're done serving them, offer to pray for them in the name of Jesus. And many people are open to prayer. Even if they're not willing to come into the church, they're open to being prayed for by someone who they know loves them. And so I would challenge you to make that commitment if you have an opportunity. So through the month of March, there's all kinds of ways you can serve. You can go to our website, cbcbellevue.com/servetheking, to find some ways that you can serve with various local ministry partners of ours if you don't have a neighbor who's in need. And really the goal is that we would be reaching in love. So we talk about here at Crossroads being planted in truth, rooted in community, and reaching in love. And so this is a way that we, as we're rooted in community in our community groups, can think beyond ourselves to bring the love of Jesus out to our world, to be his light, to a dark world, and to show people his love. So I challenge all of us, whether you're in a community group already or if you're not, come talk to me after this service, and I'll help you find a community group that's serving in the month of March, and let's be a presence of Christ's love in this community. And you might be asking, well, what difference can we make in a single month? What difference can we make with just one way of serving? And I would just challenge us to have a far-sighted vision here, as Pastor Keith talked about even this morning, that we would think long-term here. Sure, maybe we won't make a huge impact through the month of March, but what if we serve as an example for one other church this year that sees what we're doing and says, hey, we could do something like that too? And then what if that catches on all throughout King County, Snohomish County, and various other counties? And in 10 years from now, imagine if the local government officials or people in our neighborhoods, when they run into crisis, the first people they think of to ask for advice or to seek help are people from the churches in their community. Wouldn't that be an amazing reality? And so that's the vision that I hope we have as we think about doing this year after year in the years to come. If you're new here at Crossroads, we would love the chance to get to meet you. We have a Connect Center just outside these doors at the back. We have a gift for you if this is your first time to Crossroads. And we'd love to just hear your story. We'd love to tell you about what God's doing here at Crossroads. So if you're new or newer here, come and talk to us. We'd love a chance to get to meet you. As I mentioned before, if you're not yet in a community group, we're inviting everyone in our church family to be rooted in community as part of our discipleship pathway as we're building disciples who bring Jesus to our world. We want to not just come to church, but we want to be the church. And community groups are a primary way that we be the church together. If you're not giving yet, there are various ways to give here at Crossroads, and so you can find some of those on the screens behind me. Giving, we often think of as something we give to God, but often what I've found is when my family gives, God gives back much more than we ever give, and it's really a gift to us more than it is us giving something to him. If you're in need of prayer, we have various people who will be under the cross to my left, your right, after this benediction that I'm about to give. And all of us are in need of prayer. I'm in need of prayer. Prayer is maybe the most important thing that you'll do this week. It is the most God-centered thing we ever do in our Christian lives. And so let's be a people of prayer. And so there will be people who would love to pray with you there under the foot of the cross. If there's anything that you need prayer for, God has commanded us to pray together as brothers and sisters in Christ. So please find someone there who would love to pray for you. Now, before we go, let's all stand, and I'm going to read to us from 1 Corinthians 15. So those who are physically able to stand, please stand with me. 1 Corinthians 15:58, this is a familiar verse, I'm sure, for many of us. Paul writes this, "Therefore, my beloved brethren and sistren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord." May we have a Christ-filled week. May we be Christ-filled lights and voices for the gospel to our world this week. Go in his light and in his glory. Have a wonderful day.